And if you're visiting, if you're looking for a church home, you don't have to look anymore, right? I'm so glad you're here. Come see me or somebody. Love to talk to you. Me and my family had a great time. We went to the Gulf Shores this past week and had a good time. And it was supposed to rain every day, really bad, and it waited until the end, and it rained really bad. And it's still going on, I think, some there. So we had a great time, good time to see the ocean and walk on that, and it's just really cool. Yeah, she couldn't go with us, unfortunately. It's a sore subject. But also want you to know that we're going to be starting growth groups up soon. And the leaders, we met this morning during class and talked about how we're going to do things. And it's going to be a great time. The sign-up sheets are in the back at the Connection Center if you want to sign up. We have four groups, one here at the building, and then we have three in the homes. And the first time we're going to meet in the homes is going to be September 11th. We're going to have a kickoff August 28th here. We're going to have a devotional here. Then we're going to have a cookout. And if anybody hasn't put up the play set yet, then we're going to try to do that. It's more than a one-man job, for sure. It's probably a four-man job, and you get together and figure out it's a six-man job. But if anybody wants to put that up before I get back, you won't hurt my feelings. But I imagine we'll probably do that the 28th as well. And then next week, of course, is Labor Day. And so we don't want to start growth groups on that day. So September 11th is when we're going to start that off. And we have room in each growth group for 14 adults. And so please sign up for that. And if all those groups sign up, fill up, then feel free to join whichever one you want. Donna, I like the new look there, shaved there. Looks good. I said, who's that guy with Vicky? I got to tell Don about that. And it's Don. He shaved off his beard. And also, I just want to let you know that we have a great program online for all of our family members here. It's called Right Now Media. If you haven't taken advantage of that, please do. It's a great resource. I can send you an email and you can plug into that. Tons of information, videos, apologetics, a lot of stuff for the kids to watch. My kids watch some of the cartoons there, and through them, I watch it. And so it's really good. Good stories. It's all Christian. And, you know, sometimes you're just worried about what you see on TV or the commercials in between the shows on TV. So it's really good. And so I just take advantage of that. And if you didn't get an email or if you need another email about how to access it, let me know or one of the secretaries. And so just a lot going on. And I hope all of you get plugged into growth groups there. Not connecting. You ever feel like you just don't connect or something's not connecting maybe in your spiritual life? With me, I've been traveling a lot July and this month. I almost introduced myself as your visiting preacher. But just traveling a lot, going to Armenia tomorrow to get my mother-in-law. So I just want to ask your prayers for that. Be there for about a week and a half. So it'll be a good trip, and going to be doing some mission work while I'm there as well. And, you know, I just didn't feel completely at peace about it. Have you ever had some kind of plans, and you didn't feel at peace about it? And you thought about, maybe I should change my plans. Or maybe just in your life, your spiritual life, you're not connecting with God. You had that feeling. And if you've been a Christian more than 3 weeks, you've probably had that feeling at some point. What do you do with that? You know, I've talked to people, and people address that in different ways, and I'll talk to you a way that I address it that helps center me on that. But sometimes that happens, and you get in a funk or a time that it just doesn't seem to be the way it should be. And sometimes we blame all sorts of things, don't we? And you think, is it my health? What did I eat last night? You know, you start thinking about all sorts of things. Is it my job? Maybe I need a change job. You maybe even look at your friends and family. It's like, maybe it's their fault. You know, it's like, what are you doing to me? And it's usually us while we in that. Well, maybe it is your health. Maybe you need to go see a doctor. But a lot of times when I get feeling this way, there's something going on in my spiritual life that causes this disconnect between me and God. And it happens periodically. And we have to recheck. You know, I love to say, you know what? Things are great. Since I got baptized, I've never had a troubled day. It's just every day's great. That's just not real, is it? We have down times, or times that we just need, we get spiritually disciplined by God, or we get a wake-up call from God. It's like, you know what? You need to make sure that things are going right. Or also, I completely believe that the Holy Spirit talks to us. Maybe the Holy Spirit's trying to say something to us. All right, and we need to be attentive and have a healthy life with God to know what that is. So the big picture here is being in tune with God. And if you see the picture, there's a lot of little tick marks and circles there. I kind of see this like a lock that you have to do it right, get all the numbers right, and get it lined up. And, you know, we don't have to be exactly perfect in everything that we do to have a healthy relationship with God, but we need to make sure that we're in tune with God. We do. And sometimes we have to evaluate and reevaluate what's going on between us and God. A lot of times people just say, you know, I just need a little tweak in my life and everything will just be great. I think a lot of people think about that with government and the world. We just need a little tweak and everything's going to be great. Sometimes we need an overhaul, don't we? Sometimes if your life isn't right with God, you need more than just a tweak. You need an overhaul. Well, maybe a doctor's told you that before. You're thinking, yeah, I just need to walk another mile a day. It's like, well, that and this whole list, and then page two, that list too. And sometimes we need that spiritually. Sometimes we need that spiritually. And so to be in tune with God, I appreciate Joe reading this passage, Luke 14, 25-33. There's a lot of lessons there in that passage, and I'm going to focus on 2 points here in this passage. I just don't have time to get into it, everything, and so maybe I'll revisit the other part later at another time. So this insight mentality, this is that center circle in this way. I think a lot of people go about their issues in a wrong way. But in order to get your life in order, you must first get the inside right. You know, a lot of people try to focus on the outside, the peripheral first, and then the inside. And sometimes, depending on the issue, that works. You know, sometimes you can work on the outside to help the inside, for sure. But the healthiest way is to work on the inside and then go out. Have you ever talked to someone that needed to be on a diet? And you can force them to do some things that they need to do. But if they're not sold on it on the inside, it's a waste. And sometimes they get even more unhealthy, right? And so you really have to commit to being right with God on the inside first. Because a lot of times when they focus on the peripheral, they say, you know, I just need to change my routine. I need to change the music I'm listening to. Probably good things. Those are good things to do. But really, if your heart's not in it, if you aren't starting on the inside, you may be wasting your time. Now, sometimes those changing the outside things can kickstart you, right? And so that's good. But the best way, I'm talking about the best way that works for me, start on the inside and let it go out. And really, to me, that is a big difference between the Jewish religion and faith and Christianity. Judaism, a lot of times, we're focusing on, okay, do all these things right. And hopefully by the end of that, you grow an appreciation of God and what He's done for you, outside in. And Christianity, inside out, you come to me, I'll give you my spirit. And then from the inside, outwardly, you'll be doing all the right things. Okay? So I believe this is the Christian way to do it, inside out. And really, God must be the center of your life. He must be the center. Okay? And I can spend the rest of my time talking about that, but I want to make some practical applications about how this looks. All right? So God has to be that center of your life. So when you're in that funk, when you're in that time where you just can't, you don't know what's wrong, it may be your spiritual life. And God may not be the center of your life the way He should be. And hey, that is a good thing that you're feeling that. Because that means you're still in tune with the Holy Spirit. And He's trying to wake you up. If you don't feel it, if God's not the center of your life, and you feel like life couldn't be better, then you've got a huge problem. You know, that's a little goes against common sense. Sometimes when everything feels great, that's really bad when you're not healthy with God. Okay? So if you feel that funk, you know, listen to God. I love this passage, Isaiah 40, 30, and 31. When youths shall faint and be weary, and young men shall fall exhausted, But they who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. This is a description of someone who's healthy with God. Even though they're working a lot for the Lord, even though they're doing things that a lot of people get weary, or sometimes when someone's unhealthy with God and they do a little spiritual work, they get exhausted spiritually. Oh, I'm so exhausted. It's because they're not spiritually healthy. But people that, even though they may be older or whatever, maybe not really healthy, if they have a healthy life with God, they're joyful. It seems like they're vibrant, awake, experiencing life, not just surviving life. For me, if I had those two options, I must be experiencing a vibrant life rather than surviving life. And if you're surviving life, you don't have to be that way. Yeah, I'm not saying that your health is going to get all better, your bank account's going to get bigger. It may, but that's not necessarily true or needed in order to have this joy, in order to have this vibrant life with God. And to me, that's good news. That's great news. So this inside out and how it works, you know, there's so many different ways of looking at this. I'm going to just talk about one way, and hopefully you'll get some gems from this, or one that you can apply in your life. So the first circle here, past this, we want to look at these two verses here, aspects, Luke 14, 25 through 27. Now, large crowds were going along with him, and he turned and said to them, "If anyone comes to me and does not hate his own father and mother and wife and children and brothers and sisters, yes, and even his own life, he cannot be my disciple. Whoever does not carry his own cross and come after me cannot be my disciple." Seems pretty strong words, doesn't it? You know, Jesus, what would be the reception if he was a regular speaker and he came in and said this? It's like, wow. That was pretty strong words. Jesus didn't smile at me when he preached. I don't like that. And he was getting this kind of reaction. People going, "I don't like this," kind of thing. And the rest of this passage, "For which one of you, when he wants to build a tower, does not first sit down and calculate the cost to see if he has enough to complete it? Otherwise, when he has laid a foundation, he is not able to finish. All who observe it began to ridicule him, saying, 'This man began to build and was not able to finish.'" That becomes embarrassing. You know, there's a lot of examples of that kind of thing. But you have to count the cost of becoming a Christian, okay? When I lived in Russia, there would be, you see all these cranes in the city. And I ask, "Why are all these cranes here? Are all these buildings really going up?" It's like, well, you know, someone will start a building, a big building, and they run out of money. And so it stays there. Then they get some more money, get some more people buy these apartments before it's built, and then they'll do some more. And so you see like 30 or so cranes doing these buildings, and it gets halfway, and some of them don't get finished at all, and they start deteriorating. It's embarrassing, right? And if you are that person, you get ridiculed. If you're that business, you get ridiculed. Who's going to go to you for support? So you have to count the cost of what it is to be a Christian. And it's interesting. I hear this at times. People say, "It's free. Christianity's free. Costs nothing." It isn't free. If you didn't know that, then wake up. Christianity is not free. I hear people teach this a lot. But it costs you, doesn't it? How much did it cost you? What'd you say? What did Jesus say there? It costs you your life. It costs you your whole life. Yeah, it's not a money, but it costs you your whole life. And I hear people and young people and sometimes middle-aged people, they say, "You know what? I tried Christianity. It just didn't work for me." It's like, you tried it. This isn't a restaurant that you go to and just try it one time. If you try it, then you don't really try it. In order to really try it, you have to live it, don't you? You have to live it. You have to put God first in everything that you do in order to give it a good try. I think a lot of people, trying it means, I went to church, I didn't get the wow factor from the preacher, people there, I didn't get hugged as much. There weren't as many attractive people as I thought there would be. The amenities weren't as much. They didn't have jelly donuts. They just had coffee and some crackers. Unbelievable. You know, and people had this this test of what it should be in a lot of its emotional value. Okay? If I don't get this emotional value, then I guess Christianity is not working for me. And Jesus, if you think about that, and you talk to Jesus about it, and those songs that we sing that talk about this, he's like, emotional value? Emotional value? Do you know what I went through for you? Do you know what I went through, the emotional value that I went through in order for you to be saved? And so people that, and I'm sure you probably have talked to people that have gone through this. Yeah, Christianity, church, it just didn't do it for me. It's like, okay. And you can talk to them. You can go at it a lot of different ways. One way is talk about your own experience. Let me tell you how it's worked for me. All right, that's a good way. And ask them, in what way did it not work? And hopefully, if you ask enough questions, dig enough, they understand that the reasons really sound petty. Right? And really, you can ask them that at the end. It's like, well, I worry that you really didn't live it, that Christian life. Because unless you're sacrificing, unless you've really died to yourself, I don't think you've tried it. You have to live it. Let it be in your life in order for you to really get out of it what you need. And so he says here, deny themselves and take up the cross and follow me. I believe Jesus at this time, he knew how he was going to die. And he said this to him, you have to take up your cross and follow me. Remember at this time, Jesus hadn't died, okay? Now crucifixion was a nasty thing. People weren't wearing crosses around the neck. Crucifixion, like to think about that, you know. Which is a little bizarre for me. I mean, if that works for you, great. You know, I don't see people wearing electric chair around the neck. It's kind of cool. If it works for you, great, wonderful. But when he said this, deny themselves and take up the cross and follow me, he said this, and you know how many times probably the apostles had moments after Jesus left? That's what he meant. And this has had to be one of the big ones here. When Jesus said, take up your cross and follow me. Okay, Jesus, cross, people die. Okay. I doubt they understood that. You know, a lot of people even today don't even understand this. And then they saw Jesus. He carried his cross. Carry the thing that you're going to die on. Not pleasant. The emotional value for me, carrying my cross that I'm going to die on. Not into that so much. I wouldn't do that, you know, if I have a spare time. But Jesus did that. And we have to pick up a cross and follow. And I think that's so key, to follow Jesus when we pick up a cross. So he's not just telling us to do something brutal that he hasn't done. Pick up your cross and follow me because I'm carrying my cross. Helps, doesn't it? So this deny yourself. When I get in a spiritual thing, I go to this. I first go to God, you know, I want you to be the center of my life. I think about in what ways are you not the center of my life. And he redirects me to this every time. Deny yourself. Deny yourself. Tell yourself no in some areas and say yes to me. And that helps. And when I do that, not just listen to it, it's like, yeah, God, but what else are you trying to say to me? If I listen to this and start doing it, wow. It's like waves coming off of me. And the unhealthy waves. And we must learn this. We must learn this and live this for us to really be healthy with God. Say, God, what ways? What's wrong? Why am I feeling this way? And God's like, well, I'm not first in your life. If you have an unhealthy relationship with somebody, it's like, you know what, I wish we were closer. Yeah, we need to talk more. Yeah, is there something else we could do to be healthy? It's like, no. It's like, yeah. You know, and people get in this relationship, maybe even with their spouse, like, yeah, I'm not willing to do that. Strange, isn't it? And people get this way with God. It's like, yeah, I don't think I'm willing to do that. And really, the best way is prayer. Just like in conversation, talking. Praying to God is amazing. It's really the most intimate thing we do as Christians with God. You come into the throne room of God. You come in the presence of God. If you think, I just like to be with God. I can't wait to be with God. Well, you can be with God when you pray. It's amazing. Open yourself up. Let Him test you and see what's going on. So what do you pray for when you're in this time, when you're in this spiritual unhealthiness? Well, first, pray for understanding of self. Of course, have plenty of time of thanks. Thank you so much. I'm humbled before you. That should happen naturally. But pray for understanding of self. God, where am I? What's going on? Help me to truly see myself for who I am and where I'm at. Because when you're in the forest, it is hard to see the trees, isn't it? When you're in your situation, sometimes it's tough to truly see yourself. And God will help you with this. It's like, God, help me to understand myself. What should be the most important things in my life right now? Pray for guidance. Then pray for understanding of action. I've really never known a time when I've prayed to God to help me with something, and He hasn't put on my heart a form of action. And maybe that action is not anything right now, but in time. But really, when you really pray to God, and you get to this level, and you go through this, He's going to call you to action in something. Like when you pray for your best friend to come know God. He's going to ask you to do something. Because who else is going to do it? You. You're going to be doing it. God's going to do it through you to reach out to Him. And then finally, strength. Once you understand things and know what you need to do, you need to pray for strength to do it. Kind of like that diet that you know you need to go on. You just need to do it. Just do it. Stop thinking about it. Stop talking about it. Just do it. When you have that clear message from God, you understand what God wants you to do. Whew. That's enough. Okay, thanks. And pray with God through that while you're doing that. And just go. Just do it. And if you continue to analyze it, the Holy Spirit is saying, you're not serious about this. And you lose that being in touch with God and the Holy Spirit. So two things from this. And this is really where I sort of had to start making my lesson shorter here. When you get through this, life makes more sense. It just does. Even though chaos may be going around you. Because once again, God doesn't necessarily take you out of the situation, right? He helps you through the situation, the chaos that you're in. Just life makes more sense. It's like, oh, that's what's going on. Oh, this is my role. Oh, this is my place. And then you would be in tune with God. And when you're in tune with God, you are more at peace. You will experience joy. Once again, even though chaos is going around you, you know, so much of the New Testament was written in hostile situations. Okay? When talking about all this peace, love, joy, hostile situations, you can experience these things amidst the chaos. And really, it's really easier to be a good Christian in chaos. It is. When everything's going great, you don't really need God, right? And that's why one reason why maybe so many people here are struggling with their relationship with God, they don't need God. They don't feel the need. And so adversity is great. It's a great blessing because it makes us, we have to depend on God. So consider it pure joy, right? When you face trials and bad times. It's helping you get closer to God. It's cutting off the parts that are weak and making you strong. And so I felt this about my trip. Honestly, as I leave tomorrow, I felt this for a while. And it helped a lot talking about it with RC, and I've talked about it with other people. And of course, praying to God. And it's like in stages. I had to pray with God and just like tell Him, explain it to Him. God, I just feeling this anxiety. You know, sometimes you just feel like an anxiety. And God, I'm giving it to You. And I had to keep praying it out. And really, what I figured out what was really the cause of this was I was focusing more on the task than the overall goal. And sometimes that happens. The overall goal is for me to be God's, is for God to use me, for me to give up my life and live for God. That's my overall goal in my life. Now, I was focused on this task to go to Armenia, get my mother-in-law, and bring her back here. And it's a good thing to do. I'm going to do it, you know. But I was focusing too much on that task. And I lost sight of the goal in my life. And so sometimes, like these praises I use, I have to pull back and then come back in order to do the task in the healthiest way. I hope that makes sense. And I believe that's pretty much what Jesus was doing when he had to go so often alone to pray. It's like, God, Father, help me to keep the big picture in focus as I do all these little tasks. Don't let me get too tied up in any little task that I lose the big picture of what you want for me in this life. We have to watch out for that. And hopefully we help each other in this life. When you see somebody focusing too much on a task, whatever that may be. It may be like a week trip like this, or maybe job, maybe whatever. And say, hey, I see you spending a lot of time doing this. You know, think of a nice way of doing this. Don't see a church as much because you're doing this. Or you just may say straightforward, you spend too much time on that and not enough time on this. If you have that kind of relationship with somebody. And so, the inside-out idea. Just want to summarize everything here. Work on the inside to help everything else will come out so much better. Because you have to be focused on God. You have to count the cost of your life. And continue to do that. Don't lose focus of that really cost your life in order to have this good life. Pray for guidance and experience success. And you'll have a beautiful life. Isn't this a beautiful view here? You know, I'm from the mountains kind of area, so I love mountains. People from Texas, I know that's claustrophobic to you. Sorry, Amy. But I love mountains and stuff. So to me, this is kind of like beautiful life. If you want the beautiful life, then you have to be with God and be in tune with God. Otherwise, you're not going to do it. I actually pray for people that aren't with God. I tell them this sometimes. I pray that your life is chaotic. Why? Because I love you. I want you to have no peace. I want you to be completely falling apart. It's like, why? Don't pray for that. Why? Because your life is not beautiful. You may think it is, but it's not. And maybe you just need to get a little deeper, a little bit worse, a little bit farther down in the hole for you to understand and look up to God. Now, us as mature Christians, hopefully we all are, when you feel that little tinge, when you feel that, you know what, I just feel a little anxiety, I feel something not right with God, we understand, I need to work on a tune-up with me and God. Now, if you can tell that your car is having fits, do you wait until it's completely broken down and you're in an awful way? Maybe. Don't do that. But if you see, obviously something's knocking, there's an issue with the car, get the car fixed so it can be dependable, so it can be a blessing to you and not a hindrance. I'm afraid a lot of people, their Christian life becomes a hindrance because they're not truly living it. And I want it to always be a blessing to you. I want to thank you, as we're getting ready to start growth groups, thank you so much for everybody in your help, in your contribution to our growth groups, to our church family. I've been blessed by so many of you. You know, got home midnight Friday night after being in the car for about 17 hours coming back. Ironmaned it all the way back from the Gulf. RC said, let's not do this again. Okay, yeah, it's a good idea. Coming back and we do things together, don't we? We go through good times and bad times together. And came back at midnight, and Irene and Dan helped look after the house. And those 90 tomatoes that came from our garden, that's on the table. Look at all these tomatoes. Someone's playing a mean trick on us. These aren't real. And so, but yeah, great. Beautiful tomatoes. And, you know, it's nice to be surprised by loved ones and God. And I'm surprised shouldn't be. We should expect good things. So in these growth groups, expect good things to happen. Expect growth. Expect maturity, spiritual maturity to happen.